Hi, I'm Jim Ward of the Middle Country Public Library, and I'd like to welcome you to another episode in our History Bite series. Today, we will discuss the Korean War, which began on June 25, 1950, when some 75,000 soldiers from the North Korean People's Army poured across the 38th parallel into South Korea. At the end of World War II, the United States and the Soviet Union liberated annexed Korea, then one country, from the Japanese. The U.S. and the Soviets then split the nation into two occupation zones, North and South, with the U.S. advising the South as it transitioned to a republic and the Soviets taking the North. As the Cold War began, two sovereign countries were then effectively established in 1948, the South as a Republican state and the North Communist. The border between the two was named the 38th parallel. In the South, the anti-communist dictator Syngman Rhee enjoyed the reluctant support of the American government, and in the North, the communist dictator Kim Il-sung enjoyed the slightly more enthusiastic support of the Soviets. Neither dictator was content to remain on his side of the 38th parallel, however, and border skirmishes were common. Nearly 10,000 North and South Korean soldiers were killed in battle before the war even began. Many American officials feared the invasion of the North was the first step in a communist campaign to take over the world. For this reason, non-intervention was not considered an option by many top decision makers. In fact, in April 1950, a National Security Council report, known as NSC 68, had recommended that the United States use military force to contain communist expansionism anywhere it seemed to be occurring, regardless of the intrinsic strategic or economic value of the lands in question. "If we let Korea down," President Harry Truman said, "the Soviets will keep right on going and swallow up one place after another." The fight on the Korean Peninsula was a symbol of the global struggle between East and West, good and evil, in the Cold War. As the North Korean army pushed into Seoul, the South Korean capital, the United States readied its troops for a war against communism itself. When North Korean forces, the Korean People's Army, backed by China and the Soviet Union, crossed into South Korea, their plan was simple: unify the Korean Peninsula once more, but under the Kim's rule. It would make Korea the first battleground of the Cold War. This set the stage for some of the most famous, gruesome battles in modern military history. It was host to the Battle of Bloody Ridge, the Battle of Chosin Reservoir, and the Battle of Inkin. The first, Bloody Ridge, in the midst of the war's 1951 stalemate, lasted 3 weeks and produced 2,700 UN casualties, but 15,000 for the opposing side. The fight at the Chosin Reservoir, often referred to as the most harrowing of the Korean War's battles, which redefined heroism as shown by U.S. Marines, battling frigid weather and fighting in the harshest terrain Korea had to offer. At first, the war was a defensive one to get the communists out of South Korea, and it went badly for the Allies. The North Korean army was well-disciplined, well-trained, and well-equipped. Rhee's forces in the South Korean army, by contrast, were frightened, confused, and seemed inclined to flee the battlefield at any provocation. Also, it was one of the hottest and dry summers on record, and desperately thirsty American soldiers were often forced to drink water from rice paddies that had been fertilized with human waste. As a result, dangerous intestinal diseases and other illnesses were a constant threat. By the end of the summer, President Truman and General Douglas MacArthur, the commander in charge of the Asian theater, had decided on a new set of war aims. Now, for the Allies, the Korean War was an offensive one. It was a war to liberate the North from the communists. The Battle of Inkin, which was a shining moment for U.S. General Douglas MacArthur, was the amphibious landing that reversed the tide of the war, forcing the invading North Korean army to retreat in disorder up the Korean Peninsula to their side of the 38th parallel. However, as American troops crossed the boundary and headed north toward the Yalu River, the border between North Korea and Communist China, the Chinese started to worry about protecting themselves from what they called armed aggression against Chinese territory. Chinese leader Mao Zedong sent troops to North Korea and warned the United States to keep away from the Yalu boundary unless it wanted a full-scale war. President Truman and his advisors decidedly did not want that. They were sure that such a war would lead to Soviet aggression in Europe, the deployment of atomic weapons, and millions of senseless deaths. To General MacArthur, however, anything short of this wider war represented appeasement, an unacceptable knuckling under to the communists. As President Truman looked for a way to prevent war with the Chinese, MacArthur did all he could to provoke it. Finally, in March 1951, he sent a letter to Joseph Martin, a House Republican leader who shared MacArthur's support for declaring an all-out war on China, and who could be counted upon to leak the letter to the press. "There is," MacArthur wrote, "no substitute for victory against international communism." For Truman, this letter was the last straw. On April 11th, the president fired the general for insubordination. In July 1951, President Truman and his new military commanders started peace talks at Panmunjom. Both sides were willing to accept a ceasefire that maintained the 38th parallel boundary, but they could not agree on whether prisoners of war should be forcibly repatriated. Finally, after more than 2 years of negotiations, the adversaries signed an armistice on July 27, 1953. The agreement allowed the POWs to stay where they liked, drew a new boundary near the 38th parallel that gave South Korea an extra 1,500 square miles of territory, and created a 2-mile-wide demilitarized zone that still exists today. Although it has become known as the Forgotten War, the Korean War was exceptionally bloody. Though the United States made up the bulk of the fighting force during the Korean War with nearly 5.3 million troops deployed worldwide by its end, more than 55 nations contributed to the South Korean cause with troops, supplies, or other forms of aid. 21 countries participated militarily. The South Korean forces, which formed the Republic of Korea Army, were established in August 1948, and by the end of the conflict, 30,000 of their soldiers were lost to the cause. Over the course of the 3-year war, more than 3 million troops, North Korean, Chinese, and Russian troops participated in what would become a gruesome border war. The toll of the war included about 1.2 million deaths in South Korea, 1 million deaths in North Korea, 36,500 deaths for U.S. troops, and 600,000 deaths for Chinese soldiers. In addition, more than 100,000 U.S. troops were injured. Today, the United States soldiers who fought during the war are remembered at the Korean War Veterans Memorial near the Lincoln Memorial on the National Mall in Washington, D.C., a series of 19 steel statues of servicemen. They are approximately 7 feet tall, and the advance party has 14 Army, 3 Marine, 1 Navy, and 1 Air Force members. The statues stand in patches of juniper bushes and are separated by polished granite strips, which give a semblance of order and symbolize the rice paddies of Korea. The troops wear ponchos covering their weapons and equipment. The ponchos seem to blow in the cold winds of Korea. At the point of the triangle leading to the American flag is the dedication stone. It sums up the service and sacrifice that America made during the Korean War. It reads, "Our nation honors her sons and daughters who answered the call to defend a country they never knew and a people they never met." I'd like to thank you all for joining us for today's episode. If you enjoyed it, click like, and if you watched on YouTube, hit subscribe. Thanks so much, and we'll see you all next time.